I really feel honored and privileged to be here amongst you on a very, very special occasion. It is a memorial lecture for one of the great stalwarts of the Indian police that this country has produced. He was a legend within his own lifetime. He had built a career and he had contributed in the process of nation building that he was not only admired, respected, and followed as a great leader in his time, but his memory still lingers with most of us, or some of us who might not have been there, but have heard about him. It's a special day that it is not only his birthday, but had he been alive, he would be celebrating the beginning of his 100th birth here this year. And probably it could be good, well, a centenary year for him, just as it is a golden jubilee year for the Border Security Force. You completed, I think, 50 years. He had very multidimensional contribution. I think the Director General BSF has just listed many of the things that he did in his lifetime. The way that he contributed, he led right from his very young age when he was there in Madhya Pradesh, and as the states were merged, and he as an IP officer got promoted into senior positions quite fast, and he was given various important responsibilities, and his contribution in anti-dacoity operations was remarkable. We all remember him for his Bangladesh, for police reforms, for conceptualizing the thing of the Coast Guard. It is he who for the first time thought that it is not only the land borders, but the coastal border, which is very, very important. Of course, raising the Border Security Force was his crowning success, and a success that will carry probably his imprint for many, many years ahead, and for centuries probably when this force raises and develops into a much greater arm and a much important arm of the Indian security setup. I was deeply impressed by his great human qualities, by his professional excellence, his very focused vision, his ability to see beyond. Probably this is an occasion for us to revisit and think that is it there something that is we can do about it and start thinking on the lines of that, how do we strategize the response of managing our borders? Now, strategizing is a complex task. It is complex because there are many variables. And of course, there are constants of differing natures. Our borders, the length of the borders, the terrain of the borders, physical features, they probably are the constants. But then there are variables, our relations with them, the bilateral equations, the changing multilateral systems, the situation in the states which have got the borders, which have got international borders, which are guarded by the border guarding forces. So all these factors will have to be factored in. And one has to develop a long-term vision. And knowledge of the past for analysis and a vision of the future for a prognosis all become an integral part of that exercise of strategizing. Physical security is important. Nobody can deny that. Particularly when it comes in the context of the border management. It's a very, very difficult task. Probably people cannot imagine how difficult a task it is to maintain the security and safety in the border areas, a long border area, 15,100 kilometers, in very difficult and diverse terrain, from deserts to marshy lands to high peaks to thick jungles, and all sorts of terrain, ravines and gorges and everything that goes into this thing. So they have to plan and prepare for the future, and that also becomes a part of the strategizing. So policing the borders is important, but it is not complete by itself. And as you are all aware, more I think I don't have to elaborate it, what India's borders are like. And it's not only the land border of 15,100 106 kilometers, but also a very long coastal border of 7,500. We have got 7 countries which have got borders with India. With 6, we have got right now a contiguous border, but we also have got a border of 106 kilometers with Afghanistan, which probably people do not factor in. And with all these countries, all the 7 of them, we have got very special type of issues, problems, or factors that have got to be factored in. Now, what are the variables which have to be factored in strategizing the response? I would like to briefly go through that to give you an idea that what are the different type of things that go. And physical features and terrain is important. I'm not going to emphasize on that because you know all about it and we had mentioned about it and I think it must have been discussed earlier also. That is a very, very important aspect of it. And just because I'm not going to talk too much about it right now, it doesn't mean that it's in any way less important. But the second important factor is the context and complexities of bilateral relations with the neighboring countries. And in all facets, our political relationship, our diplomatic relationships, our economic relationships, our security relationships, all these become an important factor. Now, you would be managing the border with the neighboring states entirely in a different way. Was it a border something like European Union countries have got with each other? Now, briefly speaking, now China, we have got a very long border. We have got roughly about 3,488 kilometer long border. A very difficult terrain, an alpine mountainous terrain, most of the time clad with the snow clad. Now, the bilateral relations with China, border is the critical and a vital issue. All the advancements that we make in our relationship with China all get centered around and become important on settlement of the border. And also, maintenance of peace and tranquility on the border. Now, there have been series of special representative level talks, about 17 rounds of them, and we haven't reached anywhere so far. But it is also true that for the last 30 years, we didn't have an exchange of a single bullet. But it is also true that the number of intrusions have gone up and down. Fortunately, in last 1 year, as I was informed, the intrusions have become much less. And some of the intrusions which had been made were withdrawn. So there is a little hope. I think the bilateral relations are looking up, but there's a need for us to remain at a very, very high alert. Pakistan also is an important state for us in our foreign relations, in our bilateral relations, and in the management of the border. We have got a long 3,323 long border, the IB and the line of control. And we have got series of problems. We have got problems of terrorism, gun running, drugs, counterfeit currency, and you name it and it is there. At the same time, Pakistan considers it a part of their strategy, that is, they have got to bog down India on issues like Kashmir, where probably they neither have any support nor have any locus standi. So that is another area, and I know that it is particularly of interest to the to border security force because they are the custodians of the border in this very difficult and a challenging border. We have got a problem with Bangladesh. The regime has been extremely helpful and friendly in the recent years. But still, we have got problems. We have got northeastern insurgencies and some of them who are able to find places there. Bangladesh government has been coming forward to provide some amount of a succor and relief, but that has not been sufficient. The northeastern insurgency continues to be there. Sometimes there have also been some routes through which weapons have come. Despite the efforts by the Bangladesh government, some of them are still able to trickle down. It's a very, very difficult terrain. And in addition to that, we have got a large number of influx of illegal migrants, and then identifying them, deporting them, taking legal action against them is a very, very cumbersome process where we require much greater coordination and help between the two countries, which probably has yet to evolve itself. With Nepal, we have got 1,750-kilometer long border. It is an open border. We don't have problems like terrorism and others. Now, there is an excellent security coordination between various agencies, and the government of Nepal has been quite effective. But being effective is not only a matter of your good intentions. It also requires the capabilities to deliver, which at times is not there. With Myanmar, again, we have got a settled border. We have got a defined border. We don't have much of a distinct problem. But we have got a problem of the northeastern insurgency. We have got a problem of drugs from this thing, which has reduced over the years, but still it happens to be there. There's a problem of smuggling. There is a problem of insurgent camps, and also the routes of getting the weapons. With Bhutan, we had relatively a much better this thing and no border dispute, but of late we find that some of the insurgent groups in the north, just like the Bodos, had been able to make the forays and find some places there for their this thing. Now the new government, when it took over, one of the central points of its foreign policy was, how are you going to engage the neighborhood? They understood that is the neighborhood was the central point, and even before the Prime Minister Modi had taken over, he had taken the initiative, and even though he was not sworn in as a Prime Minister, that on his initiative, all the heads of the governments of these countries came for his swearing in. And thereafter, he had been making consistent efforts to improve his bilateral relations with them and use all his this thing to see that while India's security interests are fully protected, they are articulated in as effective a way as possible, India is able to prove its intentions. Also that India is able to build up its capabilities despite reservations by some of the people, some of the countries in the border areas, that we are probably upgrading our capabilities, probably that became part of the exercise. It was felt that a deterrence was necessary for avoiding a conflict. Conflicts are best avoided if you have got the deterrence, which is not only a function of your intentions, but also of your capabilities on the ground to deliver what you say you will deliver. I am telling you all these things because in all the discourses amongst the border security forces, it tends to talk about force levels, equipment, communications, funds, morale. They're all important. But what about the larger picture? Is it not necessary that they are also the stakeholders? Is it not necessary that in case there is some discussion going about what do we do and how do we handle Pakistan, then there are the largest number of forces who are seeing it every day across. Has any study been made in the last 50 years, what have you seen the changes coming across in Pakistan? The ethos, the pattern of their deployment, the way that they behave, economic prosperity in the border areas, the attitudes of the people. Probably it is taken that it is not part of it. But not knowing that your border management will largely depend upon your intimate knowledge of the people, of the events, of the developments there. It could be an idea that you've got a huge force. You can always start your own policy perspective branches in the respective areas. Maybe the border security force could do it for Pakistan and Bangladesh. You could contribute a lot because what you have got from a particular perspective, nobody else has got. Either the Minister of External Affairs or from the state governments or the Ministry of Home Affairs. It is only whose eyes, day in and day out, 24/7 for 365 days, you are looking at the things in a particular perspective. Do you analyze that if certain trends are coming down, what could be the reasons? If weapons, smugglings have come down, which are the recipient groups, which are the groups, which are the... We probably will be greatly benefited. But more than that, the clout of the organizations will go directly in proportion to what you are able to contribute in formulation of strategies and making of the policies. Now, some of these border problems, say, maybe in in some of the northeastern states, maybe say in Assam, or maybe this in J&K. They are intimately related to what you have got to do at the border. And also, it requires your knowledge of the legal or constitutional regime and how it is being administered. Democracy is not only going to the ballot box. Democracy is much more than that. It is enforcing the laws which are made by the people who come through the ballot box. Now, in case those laws are violated and those laws do not remain relevant on the ground, there's no point in making those laws. So this requires a long-term strategic planning. And that will have to be country-specific. What are really the problems? You have got to find problem-specific solutions that require an R&D. Why can't there be some people who are dedicated to the research and development? It could be about the weapons, it could be about the tactics, it could be about other things, their practices, you can even have platoon level or company level exercises and try to do that. It works, it doesn't work. If it works, in what conditions it works? What exactly are the right solutions? And if the right solutions are not available here, then probably somebody else will have the right solution. There are people with much greater experiences outside the organization. Our former DGs, I think so, Mr. Prakash Singh and others, who had been great, you know, the great names. They are the legends by themselves, who have contributed so much and have got so much of a history. And there are many others here. Probably they could all be utilized once they know that is this is the very, very serious problem. And not only that they can find a solution, but they can become a very powerful lobby to see that these solutions become acceptable. Providing the legitimacy to that also requires a lot of effort. Providing a certain critical mass to that, the right argument, also requires a lot of effort. And from that comes the higher upgradation of the technology, the force multipliers. And in case you are not going to depend so much on force proliferation, which now I think with the Finance Commission having reduced the share of the central government in the total revenue, that is this thing from 34%, now 46% is going to the states. There will be much smaller kitty available. And all of it is going to affect the states. So proliferation of people may not be the thing. Maybe that is, you have got to improve your what we call as the force multiplier, command control factors. What should be the pyramids? We have just taken a very standardized pyramid of structures of the police forces. It may be good. I have got no experience of it. But can somebody start thinking from the 0.00 on abscess and ordinate thinking afresh? That is, we go for a more different type of this thing. Can the forces be made more compact? Except India, nowhere the border guarding forces are done at the battalion levels. Probably it may also help in giving the leadership role to the younger officers. Probably it may also bring in much greater specialization. Maybe the smaller units which have got a particular specialization may be suitable for sector X, for 100 kilometers or for 50 kilometers, people who have got a particular type of experience. I'm not giving answers, I'm only raising questions. Do we take it for granted? Communications, can it be more secure? Can it be faster? Can it reduce your number? Intelligence is also a force in this thing. And let me tell you one thing. That is, thinking that intelligence agencies will provide you the tactical intelligence will never happen. Even if every intelligence agency tries its best to do that, because each intelligence has got a shelf life. And if intelligence input has got a shelf life of, say, 8 hours or 12 hours, for how long a penetrating gang or a group passes through the border, then the time taken for its collection and for its dissemination itself will be much more than what is the real operational time this thing of that. So you have got to develop those capabilities. It should be an integral part of the thing. Tactical intelligence will have to be done. What the intelligence agencies can go and do is the collection of the intelligence, which has got a longer shelf life, which are helpful in policy formulation, which are helpful in allocation of resources, which are helpful in having the government pre-warning the government about certain type of threats. Similarly, I think building up the databases about each sector, about each border, about each district, and then going even for the mega data and handling of the mega data.
Now, for coastal security, I think we have just started a mega data center in Gurgaon, where every boat that comes into the territorial waters of India, every boat, will be chartered here, and if it revisits or it is anywhere in the latitude and longitude of the 200 nautical miles of India's this thing and 2.3 million square kilometers of India's exclusive economic zone, it will be put and tempered on the thing. So, friends, you are all very experienced. You have got a great future. Actually, most of us, we are the balance we have got and we have finished our careers and things like that. But the challenges that you are going to face in the future are going to be much more complex. The border forces will have to become an integral part of the strategic, they have got to become the strategic stakeholders. And they will have to be recognized, and nobody will recognize you unless you have got the capability to achieve those heights. And for achieving those heights, doing the things perfectly, what you had been doing for past 50 years is probably not the answer. You have got to upgrade technologically. You have got to think of the new parameters, new thinking. That is how I look at it at this age. So it is a great occasion for us. It is the 100th year of Rustamji's this thing. It's also the 50th Golden Jubilee celebration year of the Border Security Force to probably reinvent ourselves, think afresh, think of new ideas, new horizons, and achieve new heights. Thank you very much.